coming out tonight. My name is Lucy Atwood Starr, and I'm the chairwoman of the Young Americans for Freedom chapter at the University of Utah. Thank you. We stand for traditional values and conservatism. As YAFFers, we do initiatives like the 9/11 Never Forget Project, Pro-Life Timeline, and Detransitioner Day of Visibility. Additionally, we host meetings, watch parties, and speakers like the one you're going to hear from tonight. If you're interested in learning more about our chapter, or you feel alone as a conservative here at the University of Utah, you can chat with one of our members tonight or check us out on Instagram at YAFFAtUtah. We'd love to get you involved. Thank you to all of the volunteers in campus security who are helping us today. Also, a great thank you to Young Americans Foundation for making this event possible and for supporting us, given our administration made it clear they only wanted to publicly support those in opposition. From starting a YAFF chapter a year ago, we have had tremendous success in bringing speakers and hosting events to give a conservative perspective to students, which is almost non-existent here at the university. While advertising for this event, myself and another member were harassed in our car by a leftist who recognized us from putting up the flyers, which they proceeded to tear down. With a new flying rule of only one per event per board, which seems oddly targeted due to our ability to put up thousands of flyers, some have attempted to get us in trouble by moving our flyers to be in violation of this policy. One of our members has even been followed for approximately an hour while putting up flyers. At least four buildings have been made flying boards department only, and several have been completely taken down. YAFFAtUtah will continue to be strong and stand for what we believe in. I am pleased to announce we are not going anywhere. In fact, we are just getting started. Now it is my honor to introduce tonight's speaker. Our speaker tonight is Michael Knowles. Michael is an intelligent and eloquent conservative commentator who loves sparking dialogue by speaking on college campuses around the nation. Michael is the host of the Michael Knowles Show at the Daily Wire and the book club at PragerU. He is the best-selling author of the book Speechless and the satirical best-selling book Reasons to Vote for Democrats. Let's give a very warm welcome to Michael Knowles.
Very kind. Wow. Thank you. Thank you so much. That's very kind of you. Stop it. Get out of here. You're going to make me blush. I'm a little too swarthy to blush, but I appreciate it. Thank you so much for having me. What a welcome. It is a pleasure to be here at the University of Utah. I want to thank the students for the invitation. I want to thank YAFF, as always, for hosting. I want to thank the Logan family for sponsoring this lecture series. I especially want to thank the students for putting this event together. After some recent campus run-ins with the left, Antifa in particular, a burning effigy, an explosive thrown at the lecture hall when I was walking on stage, it's been a kind of crazy year. I assumed that things would be calmer in meek and mild Utah. Turns out I was wrong. I learned this when I came across a viral video a couple days ago of a wild banshee-like lady assaulting one of the students here as a student was hanging up flyers for this lecture tonight. Even in Utah, it seems, the state comprising the nicest and most polite people in all of North America, conservatives are not safe to express perfectly ordinary, mainstream, common sense views in public without harassment. Not even in Utah can conservatives retreat from the cultural war, which the left has initiated and which the left will continue to wage until they conquer the entire country or until we beat them first. The common sense view to which the protester objected is banal and self-evident. Men and women are different, and men can't become women, and women can't become men. I will not belabor the point. I've spoken on this topic many times on all sorts of stages around America and beyond, on university campuses, at political rallies, notably at CPAC, and lots of other places along the way. If you have not gotten the message yet, I would encourage you to watch some of those other speeches and to read my book, the one with words or the one without words, or just look in the mirror. If you do any of those things honestly and with a spirit of sincere inquiry, you will come to the conclusion that statistically every single person for all of history has come to, namely, that men and women are different. I would like to take on a slightly different matter this evening. That is, why America in particular seems so suddenly confused on the difference between boys and girls. Contrary to the pretensions of purple-haired, perpetually aggrieved American leftists, the obsession with turning fellas into ladies is not universal. Transgenderism is a largely American phenomenon. According to a recent study out of Virginia Tech's School of Medicine, 80% of sampled diagnoses of gender dysphoria come from the United States. 80%. Is there something in our water? Is it the seed oils, perhaps? Maybe it is the seed oils. Is it something in the air? Maybe. I suspect, however, it has more to do with politics and social fads. But whatever the cause, transgenderism seems to be an especially American problem. There are not sufficient data to say that America is the most trans country in the world. There is a lot of evidence to suggest it. But then other surveys award that dubious distinction to Brazil, or alternately to Germany, to Sweden, to Switzerland. We just don't know. Transgenderism is a weird, relatively new, still niche thing, and we don't yet have reliable numbers. We probably won't have reliable numbers anytime soon because trans identity is growing exponentially. Back in 2016, the New York Times reported that the number of trans-identifying adults in the U.S. had doubled in just 5 years to 1.4 million people. Within a span of 5 years, the percentage of the adult population that identified as trans jumped from 0.3% to 0.6%. That alone is a pretty crazy statistic. That means that one out of every 167 American adults in 2016 thought that he or she was transgender. But then, just 6 years after that, the statistics got even crazier. According to a 2022 Pew Research Center survey, the trans identity rate jumped 167% since 2016. It jumped a whopping 433% since 2011. But even that does not represent the enormity of the spike in trans identity, because when Pew researchers narrowed in on American adults under the age of 30, they discovered that these younger adults were well over three times as likely as the general adult population to identify as trans. Pew found that 5.1%, more than 1 in 20 American adults under the age of 30, identify as trans or non-binary. That does not even address the growing rates of gender confusion among children, a phenomenon in which the United States is a particular outlier, even in the West. As the American political establishment, up to and including President Donald Trump, up to and including President Joe Biden, we can hope that number 47 ends up being Trump, then we'll probably get rid of a lot of these spiking phenomena. No, not Trump, up to and including President Joe Biden, encourages, and in some cases even mandates, the transing of American children. At the same time, governments and other authorities throughout the West are banning the transing of kids. 2 years ago, the United Kingdom announced that it would close its child gender clinic. Just a few weeks ago, the UK National Health Service went further by banning child puberty blockers throughout the country. Why did the Brits turn away from trans procedures? Because their National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, NICE, is that not the most British thing you've ever heard in your life? NICE discovered that the procedures don't help people. NICE examined whether the trans procedures help to relieve gender dysphoria, anger, anxiety, body image issues, global functioning, or psychosexual functioning, on every front, it found that the evidence for benefits was, quote, very low. A separate review for the benefits of cross-sex hormones found that all the studies which showed medical benefits were, quote, uncontrolled observational studies which are subject to bias and confounding and were of very low certainty. In other words, even beyond the philosophical and anthropological absurdities of transgenderism, the UK concluded that the medical claims of the pro-trans crowd are completely bogus. The UK is not alone in transitioning away from transing the kids. Also in 2022, Sweden's decidedly liberal government restricted trans procedures for minors, noting that they should occur, quote, only in exceptional cases because, quote, the risks of puberty-suppressing treatment and gender-affirming hormonal treatment currently outweigh the possible benefit. The Healthcare Investigation Board of Sweden's similarly liberal neighbor, Norway, also recommended that trans procedures such as puberty blockers be categorized as experimental. Finland, too, greatly restricted trans procedures after scientific review on the basis that, quote, medical gender reassignment is not enough to improve functioning and relieve psychiatric comorbidities. Then, also in 2022, the French National Academy of Medicine recommended that, quote, the greatest reserve be undertaken when considering puberty blockers and hormone treatments given the risk of, quote, impact on growth, bone weakening, risk of infertility, and other harmful side effects. Meanwhile, back in America, our own ruling class is moving in the opposite direction. As Europe began to ban the transing of kids, America's rulers, up to and including Mr. Biden, issued orders to expand it. In June of 2022, Joe Biden signed an executive order calling on the Departments of Education and Health and Human Services to increase access to trans procedures, in particular for children. Joe Biden signed the order, creepily flanked by minors. As he did it, he said, quote, my message to all the young people, just be you. Just be you, Jack. Come on there, Corn Pop. Just be you. This, of course, was ironic, as he was signing an order urging kids to pretend to be something that they are not. In the 2 years since Joe Biden promoted transing the kids by executive order, he and his administration have only become more militant in their embrace of trans ideology. We saw this last week when Joe Biden ordered that Easter Sunday be redubbed the Trans Day of Visibility. Perhaps Joe Biden, a supposed Catholic, hoped to receive support from his church for declaring a new trans holiday on the holiest day of the Christian calendar. If that is what he was hoping for, then he was just sorely disappointed. Because while Pope Francis has a reputation for being more liberal and progressive than his pontifical predecessors, he has been unequivocal in his condemnation of gender ideology. Just today, in fact, the Pope released a document reaffirming the view that trans ideology is a, quote, extremely dangerous instance of ideological colonization. Quote, a concession to the age-old temptation to make oneself God, entering into competition with the true God of love revealed to us in the gospel, and a denial of, quote, the foundational, most beautiful, most powerful, and greatest imaginable difference that exists between living things. Not to put too fine a point on it, but this pope, so often cited by liberals, warned that transgender ideology threatens to eliminate the anthropological basis of the family. He observed that, quote, biological sex and the sociocultural role of sex, gender, can be distinguished but not separated. And finally, he concluded that all attempts to advance this ideology are to be rejected. Joe Biden, of course, has never been deterred from error by his supposed faith. So while practically everyone turns away from transgender ideology, Joe Biden has doubled down. And it's not just Biden. It's the whole American political establishment. When it comes to transgender ideology, America is a radical outlier. So how and why did America become so intent on turning men into women? We didn't invent transvestitism, transgenderism, cross-dressing. Cross-dressing has existed for all of history. Sometimes it has been tolerated, and other times it has been discouraged. But cross-dressing differs from transgenderism in that cross-dressers know that they are not really the sex that they pretend to be. Sometimes transvestitism has been understood as a joke because men in women's clothing is inherently funny. Sometimes it has been an expression of sexual perversion. Sometimes it has been evidence of psychosis. But not until recently was cross-dressing understood to mean that a man really might be a woman. That all changed about a century ago with the establishment of the Institute for Social Research in Weimar, Germany. Its founder, Magnus Hirschfeld, had spent over two decades running the world's first pro-homosexual activist group. LGB, we would now say. He founded the Institute to add the T. Hirschfeld actually coined the term transvestite, and his institute performed the world's first sex change, quote-unquote, operation. The first ever such operation was performed by Dr. Felix Abraham, who chopped the healthy breasts off a woman in 1926, then amputated the healthy phallus of an employee of the Institute in 1930, and then mutilated a Danish painter's genitals the following year, a procedure which killed the painter 2 years later. Hirschfeld's Institute did not survive the collapse of the Weimar Republic and the subsequent World War, but transgenderism returned to the public consciousness the following decade when a British physician, Sir Harold Gillies, mutilated a woman named Laura Dillon to look more like a man. Then, after the war, transgenderism fully and finally penetrated the popular culture through the celebrity of George William Jorgensen. I should probably pronounce it Jorgensen. I'll pronounce it the American way. I think it's Jorgensen. Better known, if you haven't heard that name before, as Christine, an American GI who underwent the so-called sex change procedure in Denmark and became the most famous trans individual, at least until Bruce Jenner, maybe even more than Bruce Jenner. It took over three decades from the founding of the world's first trans clinic for that to make it to America. It took another 15 years after this very famous procedure before we had the establishment of the first American trans clinic. This was the Gender Identity Clinic at Johns Hopkins, which was founded in 1966 and which was then shut down 13 years later after the head of that clinic, Dr. Paul McHugh, observed that the procedures do not improve the patient's psychiatric condition. There is no one in the entire world who is more expert on the transgender surgeries than Dr. McHugh, and after consulting the evidence, he concluded that they don't work, so he shut it down. The year after Dr. McHugh shut down the trans clinic at Johns Hopkins, gender identity disorder made it into the third edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, better known as the DSM. Today, pro-trans activists get quite upset over the suggestion that a guy who thinks he's a woman might have a screw loose. But in 1980, the inclusion of gender identity disorder in the DSM represented a significant leap forward for pro-LGBT activists, as it helped to justify the increasingly preposterous sex reassignment surgery. If cross-dressing were merely understood as a weird sexual fetish, it could be ignored as a political matter or kept to the fringes in some red light district. But if gender identity disorder, now known as gender dysphoria, were a diagnosable psychiatric condition, then various treatments, even farcical treatments such as the removal of healthy organs, might be justified as medically necessary. Now, of course, we are told that gender confusion is not a mental illness or even a mild psychological ailment. Today, the pro-trans activists in the U.S. insist that a fella tossing on a dress and calling himself Sally is perfectly normal, the sort of thing that we must tolerate and, in fact, ought to celebrate. We're told that these men have a right to enter the women's bathroom, that adults have a right to indoctrinate children into this novel and false ideology, and that still other adults have a right to chemically castrate and otherwise mutilate those same children. Why have these lunatic ideas taken hold, especially in the United States? It seems to me the first question to ask is, what is a right? That could possibly be the name of my next documentary, which would not be as titillating as Matt Walsh's documentary, What is a Woman? There are fewer opportunities for humor when taking on abstruse political philosophy, but it would be a worthwhile movie to make, because this question lies at the heart of America's particular transgender problem. Right signifies an object of justice. I have a right to a thing that I can legitimately claim dominion over when others are obliged to recognize my dominion. I have a right, for instance, to my Mayflower cigars. I have one in my pocket, actually. Nice. I have a right to this. I have a moral right to this Mayflower cigar. I have a legal right to this Mayflower cigar. You do not have a right to my Mayflower cigar. If you go to MayflowerCigars.com, you could order your own Mayflower cigars. But not in Utah, unfortunately. So you got to smuggle them in. It's amazing. We have a totally open border. We got the cartels controlling everything. You get anything into America, you can't get Mayflower cigars into Utah. Something's gone terribly wrong. Maybe if you go to another state, and if you're 21 years or older, some exclusions apply, then you can order it. In any case, as it relates to justice, wrongs cannot be rights. Right? It's right there in the name. It's right there. It wouldn't make any sense. Rights are understood from the perspective of law. And there are different kinds of law. The civil law, for instance, which governs our societies and differs from place to place. There is also the natural law, which does not differ from place to place and which can be understood by all men simply through our use of reason. Good is to be pursued and evil avoided. For instance, that would be the basis of the natural law, the sort of thing that is always true and understood to be true by all men everywhere. I mention all of this because the law, and therefore rights, are not just a matter of preference. They are not just a matter of individual will. Rights are necessarily grounded in reality. They are grounded in objective truth knowable through our reason. Or, if they're not, then rights become meaningless. And the way that rights are discussed today is precisely that, meaningless. Today, anything anyone might fancy is called a right. The right, for instance, to kill a baby in the womb, the most ridiculous of all the fake rights, because it directly contradicts the legitimate and bedrock right to life, without which no other rights can exist. Or else we hear of the right of a man to use the women's bathroom, or now even the right to be called by the wrong pronouns. None of these rights withstand even the slightest scrutiny because they are unreasonable. But especially in recent years, we have divorced our supposed rights from reason. And we have done this, especially in America, I think, because we are the land of opportunity. This philosophical and psychological sickness of transgenderism has taken hold, especially in America, because our nation is, in so many ways, exceptional. We began, developed, and continue to exist differently than other nations have. Within their proper limits, America's relative scope of opportunity and dearth of old world baggage have offered us great advantages. But they also pose a temptation to pride. The temptation to believe that we really can be and do anything at all, that we can transcend not just the limits of convention, but of reality. It's a temptation to transform what was supposed to be a shining city on a hill into a dystopian garden after a fall, the temptation to make ourselves into gods, a national hamartia deriving from the original and deadliest sin. On Trans Day of Visibility this year, Some of us still celebrated it as Easter, which marks the end of Lent, which represents the 40 days that our Lord was in the desert being tempted by the devil. We recall that Satan tempted him to turn rocks into bread. Then he tempted him to fly. Then he tempted him to bow down before him to gain political power. Our Lord did not do any of those things because, among other reasons, he is the Logos, the divine logic of the universe. In America, we are free to eat rocks and throw ourselves off buildings. We are free to worship unrestrained political power. But I would not recommend it. America is the land of the free, but we are not free from the truth. And we should never wish to be free from the truth, because it is the truth, in fact, which sets us free. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Stop it. Come on. Get out of here. I'm so pleased. We still have time for questions, because even though outside there are about a bazillion of those pride flags, you know, and not just the pride flag, but like the terrorist pride flag with the triangle and all this stuff. But even though the people were screaming and harassing the students, but they didn't interrupt the lecture, probably because the University of Utah cops are too strong for them. And anyway, I'm glad that means that we have ample time for Q&A.
If you would like to ask Michael Knowles a question, please proceed to the back around next to my colleague who is raising his hand, and we'll be happy to take questions.
There is a rule that I don't like the rule, but the rule is if you disagree with me, you can cut the line. I assume that none of the people who disagree with me are in this room because they're out hanging their 10 billionth pride flag on the walls of the University of Utah. But if you are in here, you can cut to the front.
Hi, Michael. My name is Rachel, and I want to thank you for coming out and talking with us today. My question is, how do you feel about transgenderism being taught to kids in school, especially like younger kids?
Obviously, it's dreadful and should be illegal. Simple enough, you know. We probably all agree with that. But it is not enough to say, as some of the squishes do, that we want to take all indoctrination out of the schools, or we don't want to talk to kids in any way about sex and family. Sure, we don't want to tell a little kid about the birds and the bees, but we necessarily will tell them something about family. Every time you read them a little storybook about a mommy and a daddy and a kid, you're imparting some kind of view of the family. Every time you talk about the difference between men and women, in a way, I guess you're engaging in sexual indoctrination, at least in as much as you're saying men and women are distinct and the sexes are complementary. So it is not enough to say, hey, let's not teach them anything. It's not enough to say, let's wait till 8, and then in the fourth grade, you know, we can start pushing the rainbow propaganda. It's not enough to just be on defense. We need to have a positive and affirmative message. We use the phrase indoctrination as a terrible thing. Indoctrination pretty much just means the same thing as education, to teach and to lead, and we are leading people out of ignorance. And to teach students means we have to teach them something. Another liberal slogan that crops up now is that we shouldn't teach students what to think, only how to think. That is a meaningless statement. It is not possible to know how to think without knowing at least to some degree what to think. I can't know how to think about mathematics unless I know that 2 + 2 = 4. So we have to teach them something, and that means that we have to have courage. We have to have a spine, which is something unfortunately lacking among a lot of elected conservatives. But we need to be willing to say, no, actually, men are men and women are women, and men look a certain way and they talk a certain way and they do certain things, and the same is true of women. And men and women go together, and that's good, and marriage has a meaning. And it's not just open to radical reinterpretation as your fancy sees fit, but it actually means something naturally. It's a natural institution. And there are certain truths that we can know through reason, and we're going to teach kids those truths. And when they get those truths wrong on papers, we're going to take points off, because that's what you have to do to teach kids anything at all. And if we don't have that positive message, will create a vacuum, and nature abhors a vacuum, and that vacuum will be filled with lots and lots of rainbow flags.
Thank you.
Hi, Michael. What books have had the biggest impact on your life that you think other people should read? And then speaking of books, my dad just published his first children's book, and you actually met him at the Latin Mass in Burlington, Vermont last year. And he would love for you to have one of the first copies, and I think it's a book that your children would love.
I would be honored. I assume this is not a sequel to Gender Queer or something. I think having met your father at the Latin Mass in Burlington, he's pretty, you know, solid guy. Is that the book?
This is the book.
I'd love it. Yeah, thank you. This is great. Wow. The book is so strange because it looks so normal. I didn't know they made normal children's books anymore. Very odd. I'm vaguely remembering them. You know, the book is The Adventures of Augie Thumb. I like that name. It's a great name. The books that have had the biggest impact on me, Dante, The Divine Comedy, really all the writings of Dante have had a huge impact. Thomas Aquinas, also everything by him, not that I've read through all of it. I'm not sure everyone has read through all of St. Thomas Aquinas. The guy wrote, he would write like six books at a time. Aristotle, certainly, Plato as well. From more recent writers, Chesterton, Orthodoxy in particular, Hilaire Belloc, C.S. Lewis also. A lot of, I guess you're getting a theme here. These are Christian writers who had a focus on politics. They didn't turn away from politics as a lot of the squishes, you know, would have it. A lot of people want to be pacifists in the church militant. Doesn't make a lot of sense to me. Those books have been very important. So many others, too. The writing of Owen Barfield. You know, the great thing about engaging with the great conversation is that you read a book, and it references another book, and then you pick that up. And then you read another, and then this is, he's talking about this guy, and then you go pick up his book. And this is something that Dante taught me, actually, about reading, which is that you can get a list, you know, here are the 500 books you're supposed to read to be smart. And you can try to go down the list. I've tried to do some of those. Here's the Western Canon, you know, and I get half a book in and I, you know, fall asleep and I lose the list or something. That's not really how education works. It's about rigor and discipline, of course, but it's about desire. And you know, you ought to follow your desire and make sure that your desire is pointed in the right direction and to cultivate good habits, and that will also help to refine your desire. And then, you know, follow that to lead you to what you'd like to read. And you'll probably find that you're circling back to a lot of authors as well, as I have with all those people I just mentioned.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah. Hi, Michael. First thing first, took you long enough to come here. We feel left out here in Utah. We don't get visited by the Daily Wire enough. But as a Catholic, do you view the ongoing conflict between Israel and Palestine as a sign of Armageddon and the impending second coming of Jesus Christ? If so, would you share your thoughts and perspective on the matter?
I almost did not finish writing my speech today because my plane was supposed to take off right at the beginning of the eclipse. And I thought, what a waste if I write my speech and then the world ends. And then I could have been watching a movie or something for the last hour I had on Earth. Then, on top of that, you referenced the Israel-Palestine conflict, I'm told that some renegade Jews are going to slaughter red heifers that came from Texas and some American evangelical, and I don't know, it's very, and then I heard the eclipse was going to pass through towns called Nineveh, and then I don't know what else. You know what I do know? I do know that no one will know the day or the hour. No, not even the Son, but only the Father. So I don't worry about it. I really don't at all. I think I have the least popular position on the Israel-Palestine conflict, which is that it's very complicated and ought to be resolved with prudence and with regard to the justice for both sides and also with regard to American interests. That's not a sexy kind of description of it, but I think sometimes if you have a more of a disinterested approach, you can arrive at better and more diplomatic solutions. In any case, I don't lie awake at night worried that it will mean the end of the world. There's a story I just saw going around today. Whether it's apocryphal or not, I like it, which was about St. Charles Borromeo. St. Charles Borromeo was asked while he was playing pool if what he would do if he were told that the world were about to end. And he said he would probably keep playing pool, you see, because he took care to protect his soul and not to fall into mortal sin. And he stayed close to our Lord through the sacraments and in prayer. And his pool playing was giving glory to God, as should everything that we do. And so that's what he would do. All of the people who are terrified over the end of the world, whether it's because of the sun or the Palestinians and the Jews or whatever, I don't know, whatever makes the heifers, I don't know, whatever. I think the world could end at any moment. Are you living your life as though you could die at any moment? Many people are not. And they really should be, because whether or not the sun augurs the end of the world or something, the world is going to end for you and at some point. And you're probably not going to know exactly when that's going to happen. And our time on Earth is relatively short in comparison to eternity. And if you're living your life in a way that is in accord with God's grace and you're taking care to maintain that relationship, then you don't have anything to fear, even if the eclipse falls down from the sky and blows us all up.
Thank you.
Question.
Wow, I feel like I'm speaking to David Bowie. I watch you every single day. I'm Italian as well. My name is Nikki Simone, and I'm a conservative musician here, and I get constantly shut out from all the venues. I constantly get, for the last couple of years, just because I'm a man, I'm strong, and they don't let me do anything in the music scene. Like online, I feel like I'm always put in these digital gulags, and it sucks, and I just want to be able to be American. Like, I love this country. I want to be able to, but I feel like with music, dude, it's just completely run by just communists, and I want to find a way where I can succeed.
You want to hear proof that all nature is but art unknown to thee, and all chance direction which thou canst not see? As I was driving to this venue late, the last song to come on the radio was Changes by David Bowie, and then you out of the blue, I've never been compared to David Bowie in my entire life, and you just happened. Were you in my radio? I don't know. Of course not. It's just providence. Sorry to hear about your trouble in the arts. This has been a long-standing problem. I was a member in my wayward youth. I worked in the arts. And I was a member of a group called the Friends of Abe, a very secret society for conservatives in Hollywood, so secret that it had a Wikipedia page. And Jeremy Boring ran that group, FOA, after Gary Sinise gave over the reins. And around this time, Barack Obama decided he really wanted to get his hands on the membership list. And they tried really, really hard. This was during the IRS scandal when Obama was weaponizing the IRS after all of his political enemies. That was before we were told that Obama never had any scandals, you know, like that one, the Fast and Furious scandal, a lot of us get Libya. Anyway, he tried to get the names, and Jeremy wouldn't give up the names. Why did he want to get the names? And why did Jeremy hold on to him so tight? Because there is a blacklist. Obviously, there's a blacklist in show business. And more than that, there's just a white list that you might not get on. Because, in fairness to the libs who want to exclude conservatives from entertainment, it's a people business. And so if you don't go to the parties and you don't hang out and you don't have a lot in common with these people, well, you're just not going to play. You know, you're just not going to be part of it. So I wish I had something really, you know, optimistic and rosy to tell you, here are the three things you do. Here's this one weird trick to make it in music as a right-winger. But there isn't one. So you're going to have to... The bright side of that is you can get rid of all the kind of rosy fairy tales about how, you know, you'll just be discovered one day playing at Whiskey a Go-Go or something, and you'll be... That's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. If you're a writer, you're not going to just magically get picked up by an agent. If you're an actor or director or producer, it's not going to happen. And if you're conservative, it's going to be especially hard for it to happen because you won't be socializing with these guys as much. So what does that mean? It means you do it yourself. And it's not the worst thing to be an amateur artist. You know, amateur is the word for lover, amatore, you know, to love something. And so if you do this for love, you know, you're a good Italian man, amatore, you know. You do this sort of thing for love, and you can produce some good art, and maybe you'll be recognized for it, and maybe you won't. But, you know, how many artists ever got rich? Like, two ever? So you can do that, and then work some other job, and, you know, it was good enough for T.S. Eliot, Dante, you know, it's good enough for the rest of us, too.
Well, I'll try to follow St. Thomas Aquinas for you. I will. I'll follow St. Thomas Aquinas. Thank God. Bless you.
Yes, thank you very much.
What would you say that young conservatives are doing wrong that maybe they could do better at, as compared to like passive or active support?
One thing young conservatives sometimes do wrong is they rush. They want to have a big audience. They want to have a show. They want to be elected to office at age 12. I understand it's a little rich coming from me since I am on camera every day and I give speeches and I've been doing it since I was relatively young. But even with me, you know, and I got my show and my speaking tour for not writing a book called Reasons to Vote for Democrats, a comprehensive guide that's totally blank, and then the President of the United States tweeted out an endorsement, and it was totally unexpected. You could never possibly plan that. But even then, I think I was still 27 or so when that happened, which was look, if I had had my druthers, I would have had political influence starting at the age of 18. But it's a very good thing that I didn't. And young conservatives who want to become TikTok stars when they're 12 years old are not doing themselves any favors. The first thing that a young conservative who wants to make a difference ought to do is read a lot, read everything. Read things that you like, you know, things that are immediately attractive to you and that are popular and modern, and then read what those authors were reading. And then read what those authors were reading. And figure out how your views are different from some other guy's views. When comedians start out, they usually just do other people's bits. They're doing an impression of another comedian. And only over time do they develop their own routine. The same thing's true in politics. Politics is often kind of a joke, but the principle would hold true even in very serious politics. You have to figure out what you think before you just go out there and blab about it on record forever, and then you know you look either foolish or hypocritical. That's the first thing. Second thing that young conservatives should do is work on a campaign. The best kind of campaign to work on is a congressional campaign because it's local, so it gives you all the intrigue and backstabbing and just mayhem of local politics, but with exposure to national political issues and institutions. So that's the kind of thing that I would recommend. And you're not going to really make any money doing it, and it's just brutal and terrible and deeply unpleasant most of the time, but you will get a fabulous practical education. So then, when you have your book learning and you have your practical experience, when you've cultivated the intellectual virtues and the moral virtues, which one hopes that you'll be cultivating your moral virtues in other places than political campaigns, you know, you're also going to church and you're also just doing good things. Then you're going to be ready, then and only then, to actually have an impact on public life. And you'll be much better for it, and you'll have a much longer career, and you will be much more effective.
Thank you.
Hi, Michael. As a college student here at the University of Utah, as you said earlier, Utah is a fairly kind place for the most part. And as a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, like a lot of Utah is, we are taught to be kind, but also to stand up for what is right. So I guess my question for you is, how do we be kind the way the Savior would, but at the same time stand up for what is right and what is good without unnecessary contention while still being in conflict?
The key is charity. Charity is one of the three theological virtues, and it's the greatest of all of the virtues. There are all sorts of different kinds of virtues. We focus often on the theological and the cardinal virtues, but there's a further distinction, which I just mentioned, between the intellectual virtues and the moral virtues. Intellectual virtues are simple enough. That's book learning, which we used to read in books. Now we probably get it on YouTube most of the time, but in any case, it's what you get through classroom type education. The moral virtues are different. You don't learn how to be courageous by reading about it. You learn how to be courageous by demonstrating courage and practicing it with your whole body. Still, both of these things are natural virtues. They're the sorts of things that are available to us and which we can perfect just through our own efforts. Then there are the theological virtues. These are supernatural virtues and they're different. And the theological virtues are faith, hope, and the greatest being charity. This, we can't get on our own. This requires God's grace, and for us to be close to God and cultivate a relationship with God, and when God comes all the way down the mountain, to not turn away from him, but to actually cooperate with him. That is the key. Charity is the key to the whole thing. You can be the sharpest debater in the world. You can have all the facts. You can be quite courageous. You can have cultivated all of the natural virtues. And if you don't have charity, you will be a clanging gong. I mean, you will just have nothing. You won't persuade anyone ultimately. You will imperil your own soul. You'll just be basically good for nothing. So that's the way to do it. I go around and I speak, not here apparently, because I guess they're all off at another event protesting. But I was just speaking at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and it was very chilly there, so all of the protesters came inside and ended up speaking with me. And so I look a guy in the face. He's a guy wearing a dress, and he has a kind of a nasty question. And I tell him, you know, you're not really a woman, and you're totally wrong about this. But, you know, you don't need to be totally wrong. You're a guy, and I'm sure terrible things have happened in your life, and something's led you to this point. And so I'm not going to sugarcoat it, though, because that's not... That wouldn't be charitable. Clarity is charity. But it's really kind of about the intention. I'll give you a good example of this. I just interviewed a former porn actress. She was one of the biggest porn actresses ever on OnlyFans. This is like a do-it-yourself pornography. And she had made, over the course of 4 years, $9 million. We're talking, that is... I considered signing up for OnlyFans. I don't think I would do very well. And no one does. I mean, OnlyFans is a total scam and a fraud, and the median income that you get on there is $180 a month or something like that. But this woman did really succeed at it, and she walked away, and she says she's had this major conversion. And so I just interview her and just ask her to tell me about her story. You know, that's pretty much it. And goes up. And a lot of people really liked it. I mean, it instantly got millions and millions of views. A lot of people really liked it. But I noticed there were some people who were really harsh on this girl. And they said, she's a fraud, she's a grifter, she's just trying to scam Christians out of money. One person, a somewhat prominent right-wing person, said she can never atone for her sins. She just needs to be cast out of society. And this, I think that would be kind of in the clanging gong category. It's not only false, it's not only contrary to revealed faith, but it's just so nasty. You could say all these things. You could say OnlyFans is terrible. You could say that people are responsible for their actions. You could say that you're going to have a tougher time in life. You could say you got a lot of reparation to do. You could say this, that, and the other thing. But what do we want? Do we want these people to have a better life or not? What is charity? Love is willing the good of the other person for their own sake, not merely instrumentally for us. So do you want that? I do. I like to think that I want that, and I endeavor to want that even more. That's a gut check that you can make. You will know that yourself. And the moment that you find yourself, you know, smacking down the libs with facts and logic in order truly to destroy them, that's the moment you ought to take a step back and reassess your own priorities.
Hi, Michael. You know you're in Utah, right?
I've been told.
Okay. I was late today. I made it in by the skin of my teeth because I got you a copy of the Book of Mormon.
it's very kind.
Can I bring it to you?
I'm getting so many books. Well, thank you. Kind. I once started to read the Book of Mormon. It was in a hotel, but it was late at night, and I assume it was in Utah actually. But it was kind of late at night, and it was kind of interesting. But then I fell asleep, and I didn't pick it up again. I figured I did the same thing I guess with St. Thomas Aquinas. I did the same thing with St. Augustine. Well, I had a problem finishing some of these works, but I really greatly appreciate it. I don't know very much about LDS. Or Mormonism, or I don't even know what term I'm supposed to use. But one thing I do like about it, just having spoken to some of my Mormon friends, is while I do not agree with the Mormon view of, say, the Trinity, or I guess the rejection of the Trinity, and while I don't agree with certain of the historical claims made by LDS, There's quite a lot that, in principle, I really like. For instance, the principle of apostolic succession, which is missing from a lot of Christian denominations today. That's a principle upheld, as far as I understand, by LDS. At least the principle of the divinity of Christ, albeit in a different way than the Nicene and Trinitarian understanding of it. So in any case, appreciate it. And next time I come back to Utah, I'll have more than those three observations to make, perhaps. But,
absolutely. Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, Michael. Big fan. I watch you every morning while my son naps his first nap.
I hope you have it playing so it's just infused into his head.
Sometimes during diaper changes, yes. but as a member of the creme de la creme, I really appreciate all your thoughts. So I was really wondering, since we had our first child in October, what can my husband and I do to continuously reaffirm his true gender and make him know so that he's confident in who he is, he knows who he is, so that when this ideology eventually comes for him, he can stand up for himself, for what he believes in, and just be strong and confident in that, and same for all of our kids.
How old is he now?
He's 5.5 months.
5.5 months, so it's going to be at least like 13, 14 years before you can get him to smoke Mayflower cigars. I'm joking,
a little longer.
For the lawyers. I'm joking. That'd be one. That's for the future to think about. Then, at the moment, look, 5 months, we're joking about 5 months being so young. It's never too young to start thinking about this because education is about the whole person. It's how you're brought up. Education occurs at the dining table. Education occurs in the little looks between mommy and daddy when we're all sitting in the living room. You know, it's just happening all the time. Kids are like total sponges that way. Now you have to think in particular about it because the formal education that your child might get, even 10 years ago, would not have been rainbow-colored. You know, there might have been disagreements over philosophical, ideological questions, but there wouldn't have been an anthropological question. You wouldn't have had to ask your school principal at the orientation whether they think boys can magically become girls and whether children ought to be castrated, you know, in the fifth grade. So now you do have to do that. And one way to do that is to integrate all of these aspects of your life. You have a religious life, some kind of, presumably, everyone has some kind of religious life. You have a family life. You have an extended family life. You have a recreational life. You have a friend group life. You have a school life. You have a culinary life, for goodness sakes, okay? And we live in a modern age where all of that is compartmentalized. And we're told, you know, you go to Sunday school and you learn one thing and then you immediately contradict it at Monday school and then you go home and, you know, mommy and daddy are yelling at each other or something and then you ship the kids off to, you know, play with their friends unsupervised and then whatever it is, it's as though we're all having multiple personalities. Is it no coincidence? Is it no surprise, rather, that we would have an identity crisis in the country right now? A further integration is what is key, because we're integrated beings. You know, we're body and soul. When our body and our souls are in conflict with one another, we're going to have an identity crisis. When, as the trans movement tells us, you know, the soul is one sex, but the body is another. It's totally preposterous. When our families are in conflict with one another, we're going to have an identity crisis. And when our communities are in conflict with one another, we're going to have turmoil and strife. And when the whole polity is in conflict with him who makes the polity, when our body politic is in conflict with its spirit, with its soul, then you're going to have a lot of problems. So you've got to integrate all of those things. Is that possible everywhere in America? Maybe, you know, you have to be very intentional about it. Utah is kind of removed a little bit. It's still a little bit the wilderness here and has a little bit of political sovereignty left. I fled Mussolini's hellscape of California to move to the free air of Tennessee. Yeah, I mean, a lot of us did. That obviously allows me some greater control over that. But one has to be very, very intentional because the left is very slippery, very deceptive, and you could wake up in 10 years and find out your kid has been raised totally contrary to your wishes, and you didn't even know it was happening.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Hi, Michael. My name is Brian. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well.
That's good to hear.
Thanks for coming.
So I've got a little bit of a two-parter. So my dad ran into Candace Owens in an airport, and he got a picture with her. So I was trying to kind of one-up him, one-up my old pop.
Let's do it.
Okay. Is it all right if I invite? Yeah.
Let's do it.
Is it all right if I invite my girlfriend?
Yeah, yeah. Come on.
Okay.
Yeah, here we go. That's great. And I actually brought Candace Owens. No, I'm joking. Okay.
And then that leads me to my second question with my girlfriend. So I'm currently in the military.
Thanks for your service.
Thank you. And this is kind of like a harder question than just the previous person that asked, because you were kind of talking about unity with the family. And one of my biggest fears, because the next big stage of my life is asking the big question, right? But then with a family and, you know, with the military life ahead of me, and I can go into why I'm in the military and why I'm thinking I need to stay in, how do I reconcile protecting my kids when I'm away, over, you know, just the transgenderism movement polluting their minds?
My grandfather, both of my grandfathers were in the military. And my maternal grandfather was a navigator on a B-24 over Europe during World War II, but he was just in for the war and then he got out. My paternal grandfather was a career man. He was a Navy captain, and so he was in it for a long time in pretty dangerous situations. He ran a base, Na Bay, during Vietnam, and had long deployments. I asked him on the occasion of his 60th wedding anniversary to my grandmother, I said, what's the key to a successful marriage? 60 years. And he said, well, three things. Patience. Need a lot of patience. Second thing, shared experience. My grandparents had six kids. And maybe some miscarriages along the way, a lot of pregnancy. So, you know, well, that's a lot of months of pregnancy. And the third thing that's very important for a successful marriage is frequent absence, which he had a lot of in the military. And absence made the heart grow fonder till a certain point. So, look, I don't... They have had just about as successful a family as one could possibly imagine, and it was not destroyed by him serving his country, which is an intrinsically admirable thing to do. As to how you protect your family while you're away, well, you got to make sure that, you know, mama's not just doing all the work alone. We have a society that is increasingly alienated and isolated and compartmentalized, and so it's very easy for those burdens to fall on one spouse. There used to be such a thing, though, as community and bigger families. In Utah, they still have big families. Whenever I hear of someone having more than four children, I always ask, Catholic or Mormon? Those are the only two only two possibilities. So bringing the extended family in, if you're living on base, that can foster a really great sense of community, especially if you share beliefs. You know, unfortunately, the top brass over at the Pentagon seems to be dyeing their hair pink and, you know, reciting passages of genderqueer. But most of the officers and the enlisted guys are still normal, like reasonable people, probably much more reasonable than the average civilian. So you're actually, I think, in a pretty good position in that regard. And then frequent communication, you know, writing and calling as much as you can when you're deployed. That, for my many family members in the military, that has been very, very helpful. And forming those habits young. We're really, really squishy and spongy and malleable when we're really, really young. And every second counts. So when you are home, you got to make sure that that time's very intentional. When you're sitting down to meals, you got to make sure you're saying that grace before the meals and you're cultivating those habits and you're teaching kids turns of phrase and ways of thinking that are going to shape them and allow them to continue to develop even in your absence, your brief absences when you're deployed, but then ultimately in your absence when they grow up and they go off and they have to live on their own. That's the whole point of raising kids and of education in general.
Thank you. Thank you.
This will be the last and final question.
But these have all been so challenging, you know, so violent and loud, and no, they've been very, exactly what, fine, Utah is totally vindicated. And even though the pre-show was full of wailing and screaming and gnashing of teeth, the classic, have there ever been more polite, well-reasoned questions asked at any, I don't think so. Utah really living up to reputation.
Well, let me shake it up. No,
here
kidding.
We go. Take this, Knowles.
Intellectual uppercut. No, just first, as a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, it's a pleasure to be here to see you not only talk about politics, but to preach Jesus is the Christ, that he's our Redeemer, and keeping that in the, you know, in the public eye, just, yeah. I really appreciate that. So thank you. My question for you, it's a little more lighthearted. I saw recently that you made a video about your extended family member, Beyonce Knowles.
Mm-hmm. My cousin Bay.
Your cousin Bay.
She's the only royalty I'm related to.
Queen Bee.
Queen Bay, yeah.
Well, you were talking about her Jolene cover, and you work with Ben Shapiro, who kind of broke the charts with Facts.
Yeah.
What are the odds that you're going to... release your own cover of Jolene?
You're not gonna.
And can I get a signed copy? Or at least a sneak preview?
Every time I think my pop music career is just about to take off, something happens, you know? So I'm really working really hard, and then Shapiro has this big hit, you know? I think, finally the Knowleses are going to make it in pop music, and then Beyonce has that terrible Jolene cover. I think, oh, this is a shame to the family. And then I was on the brink of doing a major collaboration. It was going to be me and P. Diddy. We were going to break the charts. And then, just my luck, he's arrested by the feds for global sex trafficking. So I'm hanging it up, okay? All right? Shapiro can take his Grammy. Queen Bey can make her terrible covers of good Dolly Parton songs. And I will stick to political commentary.
Oh.
And cigars.
I think the musical community is at a real loss.
Well, thank you. Hope springs eternal in the human breast. Maybe there will be a resuscitation of my musical career. And if so, I'll be sure to bring my bars and jams and tunes straight to Salt Lake City.
You'll make my Spotify Wrapped. Can I shake your hand? Can I shake your hand?
Come on down. And a real pleasure to meet all of you. Thank you so much. Thank you to Utah. Very kind. See you next time I'm in town.